I'm going to talk about the feature model, which is something that is we're also working on in OSGI. This presentation is a little bit more focused on the prototyping that we did and the reasoning behind it. So Kai has already introduced me a little bit. I work for Adobe. I'm a senior computer scientist there. I'm a member of Apache Software Foundation, and I'm the co-chair of the EEG. So if you want to know about OSGI, you can always try to ask me. And Carl is on vacation, so I'll skip this slide. So we're just going to look at what were the requirements for this feature model. And then we're going to look at the model itself a little bit. There are already some building blocks that you can use. I have a little demo, and then I'll talk a little bit about what is coming, what we're planning to do. So before diving into the feature model, I guess the question would be, why do we need it? So just really as in a very, very brief way to explain the feature model. The feature model is about something like about reusable components that are bigger than bundles and that can be used to architect a system. Now, there's already kind of a number of attempts to create this. Apache Carav has something like this. Eclipse's features. There's OCI subsystems, which kind of come in this space. BND has support for this. And from the Sling community, the Apache Sling community, which is where I am also involved in, we had something called the provisioning model, which also kind of touched on this. So the feature model that I'm going to talk about today is like an evolution of the provisioning model in Sling. We wanted to make that better, and we kind of created a version 2.0 or something like that of that. But also, one of the things that we're trying to do in OSGI is to create a specification around something that could be a portable feature description that could hopefully be implemented by all the systems that support something like this. So it's not, in OSGI, it's never a rubber stamping effort. It's always about consensus and collaboration. So this really is the Sling effort as it is now, which is input into the specification process. There's already an RFP. I have a link later on in the presentation where the requirements are basically declared. And hopefully we can work together with these other communities to come to a specification that works for everybody. So the feature model is a way to architect a system that is based off OSGI components. It's primarily focused at the architect and the designer of such a system. It's not really focused on the implementation details. Like, for example, subsystems is very technical and is more about an implementation detail. The feature model is like a higher level concept. First, we obtained a lot of requirements from the community. They're already at the Sling website. And we also kind of abstracted OSGI requirements from those which are available at OSGI. So just a few high-level requirements. First of all, a feature needs to be easily authorable via text file. Secondly, we need a one-to-one mapping of a file to a feature. So if you look at a file, which is a feature, then that's the whole feature. And it's not some other file somewhere else that defines also part of this feature. The one file is the one feature. It needs to support declarative requirements and capabilities, which is like a prominent OSGI concept, which is paramount to reusable components. Because with declarative requirements and capabilities, you're not binding one component directly to another component, but you're more specifying what the requirements are of this component, and then some other component can provide this as a capability. It needs to support some sort of inheritance, which means that you can create a feature that is based on another feature, but maybe with some modifications. And there's some other interesting things that are a little bit novel. I don't think we can find them in any of the other similarly kind of focused implementations. We need to support API whitelisting. And this is important if you create a platform and you want to limit its API service. I have a slide about that later. And finally, we need to support an extensible format that allows you to add custom metadata. So if you have other metadata that maybe is important only to your particular use case, and you might have tools for that metadata, maybe you want to put that in the feature file so that it sits with the rest of the information and it's not kind of cannot get out of sync by being somewhere else. Oh, and then finally, you should be able to compose an application from one or more feature files combined. So, feature files are defined in JSON, which is handy because some OSCI specifications now also use JSON as a way to declare things. Like, for example, the new configurator uses JSON to declare OSCI configurations. By using JSON, we can embed the configurator config in the files, and that allows us to reuse that specification. They have an ID, obviously. They support something like called variables, which allows you to provide certain pieces of information, such as certain configurations, like a database name, later on the command line. You can declare your bundles, your OSCI configurations, capabilities, requirements, custom content, and you can release a feature into Maven, so you can consume it easily somewhere else. So there's already some tooling in Sling that can do this for you. And then having a quick look at the actual feature files themselves. So that's what it looks like. So here you can see we could declare some variables, and then we can use these variables later on. Now this temp-tier variable is not declared in the variable section there, but I guess you get the point. We also introduced something that is like a special type of comment. Since JSON doesn't support comments natively, although there is a JSMin comments that we also support, most editors don't like JSMin comments because they show up as errors in your text. We also introduced a special key. If the key starts with a hash, it's also a comment. So this is something we added so that it becomes easier to add comments. You can add some configurations in there, and this is the format that is defined by the OSCI configurator specification. And you can see the new named factory type configurations with the tilde. That's a new syntax. If you have factory configurations, and instead of giving them a UUID random number, we can give them names. you can declare bundles simply by referencing them. We use the Maven ID to reference them. You can also add metadata to your bundles, for example, a start order, which is relative within the feature, but also other metadata that might be relevant to you. You can also have optional bundles, and if a bundle is optional, you can have configuration that is only associated with this bundle if it is active. So that's what you see in the bottom part. Here's an example of how you create a feature based on another feature that already exists, but maybe you want to remove a configuration, or maybe you want to replace one bundle with something else. So rather than having to copy everything, you can just say, okay, I want whatever that other feature is, and then I'm going to remove some of the things, and then later on in the feature file you can add additional configurations, bundles, and so on. And then here we can see how we declare requirements and capabilities. They're just using the standard OSCI generic capabilities mechanism. And this is really interesting because sometimes, let's say you have a bunch of bundles that together implement a remote services implementation. Now, the bundles individually don't implement that. They all provide bits and pieces of this specification, but together they provide such an implementation. And this is kind of declared by providing a capability. I'm implementing the OSCI remote services specification. And you can do this by adding a capability to the feature file that binds all these bundles together. And this is another example here, where basically the feature file says, these bundles together implement this OSCI HTTP whiteboard specification. Okay, right. Whitelisting. So this is a problem that especially becomes prominent if you have a large platform that you build on OSCI, where you allow your customers or your users to provide plugins to your platform. This is something that we do, but many other people do this too. And the problem is that if all these bundles are together in this platform, then all of the exported packages for all from all of the bundles are visible to the plugins. Now, this sounds great, but it really isn't, because maybe you have a limited set of APIs that you really want to maintain and support. Some of the other APIs might be internal for your own purposes. So, you know, in this example here, we have a product, and there's some sort of product API, and there's a product commons, and there's a Sling API. Now, things that have API in the name, maybe they are usable by everybody, but this commons thing here in the middle, that more sounds like a utility class that I use as part of my product, but I don't really want to maintain that forever and ever to all my users. So what API whitelisting with regions allows you to do is to split this up. So you can say, okay, I have a global region, and the global region is the contract that I'm going to commit to for long-term support and so on. And that only that has all the packages that I want to basically give to my plugin, you know, providers. I also have some internal packages that are really just an implementation detail and nobody should use, and that basically is in an internal region. And then using the OSGI resolver hooks, this actually is enforced at runtime. So if your feature is trying to import something that it shouldn't, if it's not in the right region, it will basically not resolve. So it's a nice mechanism that doesn't really impact the runtime performance. It's really at resolve time that this is handled. And then finally, there's also an example of some custom metadata. For example, the repo init section, this is really Sling specific. So if people are using Sling, they understand what this means. But if you're a pure OSGI user, or if you're not using Sling, you have no clue. So this is not really part of the feature model itself. It is implemented as an extension. And you know, you can have your own extension. But this data can be carried alongside the rest of the feature model. And it can be processed by plugins or by custom, you know, custom tools. Okay, so how do we work with these feature models? What are the building blocks? Since they're just simple JSON files, you can just use any JSON editor that you want to use. And then, you know, to create the feature model files, and then we have an analyzer, and the analyzer can be run over those files and basically check if there's any missing dependencies, or if there's any clashes, or you know, if there's any requirements not being satisfied. So the analyzer can reason about your features. And when you're happy with your features, you can use a plugin, which is a Maven plugin called Sling Feature Maven plugin, and that will basically publish it into a Maven repository so that other people can pick it up. And with this, you can basically create a nicely, you know, reusable feature, maybe, you know, deploy it into Maven Central and say, okay, well, this feature provides, you know, this particular tool or this component, like a HTTP server, for example, and then somebody else can just refer to it and use it without really having to know the detail. So that's what happens if you create a running system. You just reference feature models. Those feature models are imported from a repository. They were given to the Maven plugin again, and the Maven plugin basically combines all these together into a system feature. There is, you know, a chance, there's quite a big chance that there's some overlap between some feature models. Maybe there's a couple of them that both define the same logging system or something like that, so there are some conflict resolution rules around this. You know, sometimes this is fine, but maybe if there's a conflict that is detected, then you have to explicitly declare how this conflict has to be resolved. A little bit like in Git, if you do a merge in Git, and sometimes Git can figure it out itself, or sometimes the user is asked to actually resolve the conflict. And the way that works is there's a specific section in that Maven plugin where you can specify how, if there's a conflict, how that should be resolved. And then what you end up is with a final system feature that you can run through the feature launcher. One part I didn't put in this picture is that you can actually add additional feature files there as well. I'll show that later, which can be useful, for example, if you want to do debugging. Let's say you have a product that is defined as a feature file. you want to run it, but maybe you want to do extra debugging and install some debugging tools. You can basically do this by adding specifying those debug tools in an additional feature file and providing that alongside your main product with the launcher. So here's some details about the Sling Feature Maven plugin. It has some mechanism to attach features to the Maven project. They are typically attached using a qualifier. It has a mechanism to aggregate features, which I just mentioned, to create an application. And it also has an interesting repository, Mojo. And the repository allows you to basically create a local repository directory that contains all the dependencies of a feature. And this is really useful if you're building a Docker image, for example. Let's say you're building a Docker image that you want to run somewhere on some Docker hosting cloud in Kubernetes or something like that, then that Docker image, when it's running, most likely doesn't have access to your Artifactory anymore, because that might be behind your corporate firewall. So with this repository Mojo, you can basically say, okay, this is the feature file I want to run, put all the dependencies in there, it's going to go in my Docker image, it's now self-contained, you can run the whole thing without any additional internet access. So that this stuff is also documented on the GitHub page. And then the feature launcher itself also has some arguments to specify certain things, like just, you know, for reference here. I guess the most interesting one is the minus V. This is one that, you know, you probably need if you use these variables. So you can specify, you know, a database user or a port number at startup, rather than having that hard-coded in the feature file. Okay, just take a sip of water. Okay, now I'm going to do a little demo. The demo is also on GitHub. And in the demo, I'm going to... let me just switch to the IDE. All right. Right. So this demo is really going to launch a simple OSGI system that has the HTTP server, config admin, and a web console. Now, these, if you have those three things, that's kind of a very basic OSGI system. So I have here, oops, I see it here, but not there. Okay. Right. So I have a couple of feature files here. I have a configuration. A config admin is something that I need. So I have a configuration feature file that has some bundles in there that defines what config admin needs to use. Now, I don't really want to know all this detail. I just know that this is the configuration feature file. Then I have the HTTP whiteboard of the HTTP server implementation. That is also a couple of bundles from Felix in this case. And it has a bit of configuration because I want to be able to specify the HTTP port. And so that's done using the configuration section here. It has a default 8080, but I can also override that later with the HTTP port variable. And this ID thing here with all the placeholders, that's just a kind of a little thing that allows you to take some parts of the ID from the Maven project so that you don't have to duplicate that information. And then I have the web console feature as well, so that has some web console dependencies. And finally, I have this GoGo feature here that is only for debugging purposes. So that's not really part of my main system, but maybe sometimes I want to enable that if I want to debug my project. So then I go into my POM. And in the POM, I can see I have a Sling Feature Maven plugin, and that aggregates a number of features, anything that starts with JSON except for the GoGo one, and it creates a new feature, which is this kind of application-level feature called webconsole.http. So that's what this creates during the Maven build. Let's run it. Make it a little bit bigger. Okay. Right. So I hope I can scroll it up a little bit. So this is just a simple command line. I'm removing a temporary directory first. Like the launcher is like a cache directory that if it, you launch something the second time, it launches a little bit quicker, keeps some caching information around. But I'm just deleting that. I'm launching the feature launcher. That's this long, reference is just in my Maven repository locally. And then I provide this web console HTTP feature. So let's just run that. Okay, it's up, and I'm gonna go to web console, make it a little bit bigger. So it's up and running. We've got 8 bundles, nice and small, and it's there. Okay, now that so far so good, nice and quick. Now let's see if I want to do this command line, providing another feature on the command line because I want to do some debugging. I'm just going to exit this thing and run another command here. There it is. So I specify the GoGo feature now as well as the second one, and I'm overriding the port number here to be 9090. So what we can already see, I can, if I press enter, I can see the GoGo shell here appearing. So GoGo is there. And now if I refresh this page, it doesn't work anymore because the port number has changed. So I'm going to go to the new port. Right. And, we have a few more bundles now, but it's working again. And I can also go to the configuration section and I can see that the configuration, admin configuration, has been applied with the overridden value of 9090 that I provided from the command line. Okay. Let's go back to the presentation. Let's see where I was. Okay, so that was in a nutshell what the feature model is about. I see that I have a bit more time left, but maybe we can use questions. Just the outlook, the things that we're working on. The API whitelisting is something that is currently kind of in flux. It's basically being developed. We also are, one of the things that we'd like to do is use a resolver-based mechanism that you can really just say, I have these requirements, I pointed at some repository, and it will just find the providers of these capabilities. The BND tools system already has this, so maybe we can use some of their knowledge to kind of realize this. At the moment, the features kind of need to be defined in such a way that they can provide all the requirements as capabilities, and the analyzer that we have already says if there's anything missing, but it would be even nicer if the resolver could automatically give these things to us. I already mentioned Docker containers. Feature files are really good for creating Docker images. I think one of the other things that we could optimize there is hook it in with the JLink tool from Java 11 to create some really minimal Docker containers. I've seen Docker containers using running Java that are about 50 megabytes, which is pretty small for Java container. And hooking into that kind of process, I think the feature models are very good for that. And obviously, the specification process in OSGI has been started. This is already discussed as part of RFP 188, and you can get that RFP from GitHub. And then finally, please evaluate the session. Any questions? Udo. No, you don't. You can just provide it in the feature file. There is a flag with the metadata that specifies whether the runtime needs to understand this or not. So if this is pure metadata that you want to host there, you say this does not need to be understood. If this is metadata to primary database, which is the Sling example that we had, we set this flag to true, meaning that if there's no plugin that can understand it, we fail because apparently something is missing. But you can just put it in there. And if it's just to look at, or if you have another purpose for it, it's not necessary to have a plugin that handles it. Milan. Yes, we have a special feature launcher.
Right. So that is the only way, or is it that I can have my spring and I can deploy feature into it and it can do
it? Potentially. I mean, the launcher is just one implementation. We do the feature validation separately, so there's a separate process that validates the feature. And then if that passes, then you can give it to the launcher. But it should be possible to create a, for example, a bundle in Felix that can accept feature files directly, and you can deploy them that way. That's absolutely a possibility.
So then you have to separate resolver from one of the features and then one the native one of the
I think when you actually deploy it, there is only one resolver, and that's the OSGI resolver. But what the analyzer does, it basically uses the resolver separately, like outside of a framework, to check what you have actually will resolve. But at runtime, there's only the one resolver. We just give the framework the bundles, and it just does its work as it normally does. There's no two resolvers at runtime. I hope it makes sense.
Could be similar to what happens with P2, for example, when you provision with P2, where P2 also has some checks on whether it's configuration, so that's some resolution.
And the framework should behave. Exactly. Yes. And by having the resolver API in a specification, and with the resolver context, which you can provide yourself, you can completely provide the same information outside of the framework as what will be there inside the framework.
How is the interplay working between this API-wise thing and the feature compositioning? So if I have five different features, and each feature you find its own whitelist.
Yes. That's a very good question. So first of all, if you opt into this whitelisting model, then by default, each exported package in a bundle in a feature is not visible to the outside. It is visible to the other bundles within the same feature. So the feature is already some sort of a boundary that is implicit. And then the regions have a name. And let's say you create a region name called internal, and you add packages to that region, then they were going to be added to internal. If another feature adds packages to a region called internal, they will be added to the same region. So one of the things, and because it's a little bit early days, we haven't really worked this out yet, but one of the things that might be good to do is to use reverse DNS naming for these regions, because otherwise there might be unintended clashes or mergings happening. But you can basically merge regions from different features by using the same name. Milan.
What happens?
What happens? It's just removed from the OSGI framework. The feature is not basically it's not something that is actively handled at runtime. It's basically a deployment mechanism. And if you remove that bundle at runtime, the bundle is gone. Same thing, if you were running subsystems, you remove a bundle from a subsystem at runtime, it's gone. There's nothing going to stop you, at least not in this model. There might be other ways to prevent you from doing that, but the feature model doesn't prevent you from doing that.
The runtime is totally unaware of the feature.
Yes, primarily it is unaware. There are some parts of the runtime that use feature information or information captured in the features, like the whitelisting uses information that is captured in the feature at runtime. But the feature is primarily deployment artifact. And you know, maybe people have different points of view, but we primarily focused on the Docker case where you have like immutable containers or disposable containers. And these containers don't change, right? If you want to change a bundle, you do a rolling update and create a new container. Now, I know OSGI supports dynamic updates, but you know, there's different ways of doing this. So maybe if there's someone who really would like to see the feature as a first class concept at runtime, then you know, that is something that is worth exploring. Any other questions?
All right.
Thank you.